am here.
I was on mute. Good evening and welcome to the Bedford TV News. I'm Dawn.
And I'm Jen.
Thanks to all of you watching live Monday night, August 17th, 2020. And remember that the news repeats on Wednesday and Friday nights on Comcast Channel 8 and Verizon Channel 38 at 6 p.m. It is also available online anytime at youtube.com/BedfordTVMA. As always, thanks to the Bedford Citizen for being the source of our news.
And tonight we have a special guest, Chris Moore, with us, who is the executive director of the Bedford Historical Society. And she's going to be talking with us about her, or the Historical Society's, COVID-19 archive project. Welcome, Chris.
Hi, thank you for having me.
Thanks for being here. So when did you start the Bedford Historical Society?
It's actually been a year now. I started in August, right around this time last year.
What an eventful year it's been.
Very eventful. Got the whole taste of everything that goes on.
So before we get into the COVID-19 project, one thing you've done is you've started a newsletter we should tell everyone about.
Right. So we came up with the idea of sharing historical houses from around Bedford and sharing that with everybody, kind of as a virtual tour to get everybody out of the house. So every other Sunday, we do a Historic House Sunday, where I'll post it on our Facebook page, our other social media, and share it on Constant Contact. And it lets everybody know some of the history of the houses around Bedford and kind of give a brief overview of them with a picture.
Well, that's awesome. So obviously, you've had some changes in your 1 year being with the Historical Society.
Yes.
How do those changes look for you since the pandemic started?
Well, the main thing was losing the programs, not being able to have the programs that we had planned, which was pretty disappointing for everybody. We lost our volunteer for a little while just because it wasn't safe for her to come into the police station to work. Luckily, she's back, which is very exciting. And we had to come up with some other ways to keep everyone engaged and keep everyone mindful that the Historical Society is still here, that we haven't gone away. So I had to come up with some different social media outlooks and keep everybody aware of us.
Tell us more about the COVID-19 archive project.
So I can't take credit for it. I wish I could, but it's been something that a lot of other museums, historical societies, historical commissions, everyone's kind of putting their own spin on it, where we're just trying to document what's happening. People don't want to believe it, but this is history. This is going to be studied in years to come, and it needs to be preserved. It needs to be collected. So what a lot of museums are realizing is that there's not a lot of information regarding the flu pandemic of 1918. They're being approached by the media, by local newspapers, by general people interested in the subject, and coming to find out there's not a lot of information out there because they didn't collect it. They didn't think it was historically significant to document. Photos are very rare. Newspaper articles are rare. And unfortunately, Bedford's no exception to that. Our archives are pretty bare as far as the 1918 flu goes. And I realized, and a lot of other museums and societies realized, we can't let that happen again. We need to document this history while it's happening. We need to think from the perspective of a future historian, what would we want to see in this archive?
So what are those things that you're pulling together to be in the archive?
So I'm collecting a lot of media information, so newspaper articles, anything that the Bedford Citizen shares or shared by other news outlets, such as WBZ or Fox News, anything I can print off the computer. In addition, we're collecting photos that people have sent us, a lot of the testing that's been going on down at the church. People have sent us photos from afar, so not to interrupt anybody's privacy, but we get pictures from the process. Another thing is journal entries. We actually had a family reach out and give us two journal entries from the mother and daughter about their experience with the pandemic and what it's been like for them and just how they felt having to leave school and have to go into quarantine like this and just how they feel. And that's extremely important to have that first person perspective.
If somebody watching this wants to submit their journal entry or something significant, how can they go about doing that?
There's multiple ways they can do it. They can contact us on Facebook and send us a message via Facebook. We do have our email address, which they can send. Right now we're using Gmail as our email. But they can also drop something off in the police station in our mailbox if they want to do it that way, or mail something to us. There's many, many ways to get in touch with us.
What is your, what is your thought long-term, since, like you said, there was nothing from the pandemic that happened, you know, earlier, with archiving these materials? How do you see that with helping Bedford residents or, you know, basically the culture and history of our town?
People are going to be able to look back and see what Bedford did during the pandemic, what news was most important to Bedford when it was going on, what were the personal stories of the kids in the high school, how they felt about graduation getting pushed back, activities that had to get canceled, such as the school plays and sports, even the younger kids, what they're feeling, having to do school at home and have their parents suddenly become the teachers, and the teachers, what are their experiences, as well as the businesses. And all of this comes together and it shows that Bedford had the pandemic, we were dealing with it, and this is how we came through it.
Wow, it'll be interesting to, well, it'll be wonderful to be on the other side of this and have it be history. We're all looking forward to that for sure.
Yes, I've always said I love history, but there's certain parts of it I never wanted to experience, and this would be one of them.
So you definitely are very active on social media. How can people find your Facebook page, your Instagram?
So they can just go on to Facebook and just type in Bedford MA History. We come right up. Same with Instagram and Twitter. We're on both of those. And we also have a YouTube channel as well. We've been uploading a lot of old meetings up onto our YouTube channel from our VHS tapes.
No way.
Yep. Tom Kinzer, our current president, digitized a lot of the tapes using a device that the library actually loans out to people. So he took all the VHS tapes and digitized them, and I've been slowly uploading them to YouTube. It's pretty cool. Some of them go back to the early 80s.
Oh my gosh. So have you found any surprises in those videos?
Unfortunately, there's a few videos that we can't tell what's going on in them because either someone's head is unfortunately in the way or the projector screen is just so grainy from the camera that they're using. You can't see what's actually going on. So it's more of a lecture than anything else. But the videos that are clear are really cool. We've got a Bedford Day from 2002, which was really neat. We've got the Minutemen. I think that one was in 1986, and that's actually one of the clearest videos. It just shows the history of the Bedford Minutemen and everything that they do and the anniversaries and the celebrations. It's pretty cool.
So are there any groups or like specific things that you're looking forward to, to add to the artifacts?
So at the moment, for the archival project,
mm-hmm.
At the moment, we haven't really thought about actual artifacts. We do have a couple of non-used masks that were distributed amongst employees at the Whole Foods that are possibly coming to us. We don't know if that's actually going to happen yet or not. So that'll be a neat piece of the artifacts to have. Other than that, photos are probably going to be the big thing next to the journal entries and the newspaper articles is photos, just what everybody was doing, how they enjoyed the shutdown or didn't enjoy the shutdown, what kind of games they were playing at home, things like that, just how they entertained themselves. That'll probably be the biggest thing.
Well, I can't wait to see some of those videos from the 1980s and also your collection when it comes together. Thank you so much for coming in, Chris.
Absolutely. Thank you for having me. And I hope everybody gets a chance to check out our Facebook page and see what we've got up there. We post pretty much every day except for maybe a couple of days. But I've got a lot of new segments that are coming up that started this week and they're pretty well received. So I hope everybody gets a chance to check them out.
Does the mannequin behind you have a name?
I don't know. I try to ignore him. I say hi to him when I walk in, and that's about it.
Okay. Oh, all right. Well, enjoy the rest of your evening, Chris.
Thank you so much for having me.
I feel like we should take a picture right now, like, of just the setup. Like, we're putting together this thing. The reason why I look somewhat, this is like a new view for me down here. I don't think people like are getting, putting this all together. Like at 5 o'clock, my internet wasn't working and something is going on with something. So I put together like this whole assembly on my kitchen table. And I mean, people don't get that. You don't just walk in and do the news anymore like we used to. And Mike's whole contraption on the other end of this to switch, like it's not easy. I can't even pull up my Bedford TV logo thing. Like, you know,
It's like I'm in the studio and I'm zooming to you while you're at your house.
Yeah. And I'm like super bored because I'm looking up to you like, but I don't have time to my camera. So we're just going with it. Whatever. If I start to group, I'll pay attention.
You pivoted pretty quickly.
I try. I thank Mike for giving me advice on the lighting and the tripod that I got to actually take it out of the box and assemble it in 30 seconds before we can get going. But tell me about the Massachusetts primary, Dawn.
Oh my gosh, it's our top story. Did you know you have four options for casting your vote? Everybody's nervous about the upcoming elections for one reason or another, but hopefully one of these four ways will help you be a little less nervous. You can vote by mail. Vote by mail ballots may be safely deposited in the lockbox near the front door of town hall. You don't have to go inside. You don't have to make an appointment. Just drop it off. You can request an absentee ballot. You can vote early in person. Early voting will begin on Saturday afternoon, August 22nd, continue on a Sunday, August 23rd, run all week and close at 1 p.m. on Friday, August 28th. Bedford's early voting polling place will be the Reed Room at Town Hall. Enter through the front door. You can see the Town of Bedford website for hours, which vary by the day. And your fourth choice is to vote in person on primary day, September 1st. All four of Bedford's precincts vote as usual at the John Glenn Middle School, 99 McMahon Road. Polls open at 7 a.m. and close at 8 p.m. If you would like to take a peek at the ballots for the Democratic, Republican, Green, Rainbow, and the Libertarian parties and read about the candidates, you can do so on the Bedford Citizen website.
One thing I'm going to throw in there real quick, because I've heard this happening quite a bit. If you get one of these by your front door, by the way, don't throw it out. Out my census, and apparently according to Bedford I live at two different addresses, even though I really don't. So I had a census worker come to my apartment on a Sunday at like 8:30, and I'm like, who the heck is at my place on Sunday at 8:30 at night? So I gave her a little bit of a hard time, and if she's watching, I my deepest regrets. But then somebody else came today and I found out that it actually is legit. So if they have their ID card and a bag and they have a smartphone with them to plug in information, it actually is true. So yeah, some of the census information was not, actually did not go through. It is important to get the census completed. So they're making their rounds around Bedford. They were supposed to have done it in April. We did a story on it a long time ago.
Yeah.
They come to your door. They are legit and they will ask the questions that are on the census. And if you do get one of these notice of visit things, don't throw it out in frustration like I did and actually go online and you can fill it out. But hopefully they should be getting the Bedford numbers done. And a special shout out to all of you on Facebook who said, no, Jen, don't yell at people. They're actually legitimate employees. So now we know. And sticking with some positive news, we're going to switch our news a little bit. You know, we usually give the COVID updates every, you know, Monday and Thursday about what they are in Bedford. And we're trying to, you know, switch to our happy PEG access news. So if you want those numbers, they are available at bedfordma.gov. The statistics are always updated on Mondays and on Thursdays, and you can get the most up-to-date numbers there. If there are other updates, we'll share them with you. But we'd like to keep it positive and happy. And so if you want to get all the details, bedfordma.gov, you can check on Mondays and on Thursdays. And yeah, there wasn't anything,
what's that? There wasn't anything new in this report this week. So
no news is good news.
Yeah, I guess. Well, final plans are filed with the Department of Elementary and Secondary Education, DESE, on Friday for Bedford Public Schools and Shawshing Tech. Both districts reported developments in letters to school households on Friday. The Bedford Public Schools are on target to begin a hybrid academic year with a remote component on September 16th. Bedford Superintendent of Schools Philip Conrad wrote that nearly 80% of families completed the recent enrollment and transportation survey, and 4/5 of them intend to send their students back to school in the hybrid model. The remainder prefer full remote learning called Bedford for Bedford, B4B. Conrad also encouraged any student households to contact the school's technology department if there are internet connectivity issues.
That's appropriate for today.
I guess Ms. Pulo will be contacting Philip Conrad's office.
Oh, gosh. Yeah, I have to take care of that before, and colleges start up soon. Note to self. Okay. Thank you for that.
They would like to make sure that everyone starts the school year connected to the internet. Shawshing Valley Regional Technical High School, which includes Bedford students, has switched to full remote classroom learning to start the school year, responding to feedback from teachers. Quote, a large number of academic teachers reported that they could not be physically present in school, either because of documented medical issues or because of the specifics of the hybrid plan chosen by the district where their elementary age children attend school. This would leave us with a critical shortage, said the superintendent of Shawshing Schools. Shawshing students will be attending school on a one-week on, one-week off model, physically present for the shop week and participating in remote learning for the academic week. Students who are identified as high needs will still have the option to attend in person during the academic week.
Youth activists Lily Nemirovsky and Liz Henning had submitted a thoughtful letter to the editor of the Bedford Citizen on behalf of the Bedford Action Team about increasing diversity in the high school curriculum. The authors are requesting that the Bedford Public Schools alter the curriculum to promote diverse stories, using the Diversify Our Narrative campaign as a guide to combat racism by raising awareness of and studying Black, Indigenous, and people of color's history and experience.
On August 3rd, the Select Board struggled to establish priorities for fiscal year 2021 amid the uncertainties of the COVID-19 epidemic and its potential financial fallout. The number one priority in 2020 was building a new fire station, which illustrates the difficulties of setting priorities in the current environment. Other goals for fiscal year 2020 included implementing projects to improve the safety of kids walking or biking to school, creating a long-term plan for Springsbrook Park, and reviewing the town's current committee structure.
I'm trying to find an eloquent way to not have my hand in the picture while I'm scrolling, but I can't do that. So this is my hand.
And you have a wrist brace on?
Well, yeah, I actually got a vertical mouse, which is really cool. But until I get used to using it, yeah, all the computer work is bothering my wrist a bit. Would you like me to use this hand? Is that less distracting?
Now that we know what the brace is for, I think we can all breathe.
This is makeshift today, you know? And this is actually very apropos. Under contract with the town of Bedford to provide cable television service, Bedford TV has shared its fiscal year 2020 annual report. But maybe that's what it was. It's the typing all the numbers in the annual report did this. I'm just kidding.
I think it did.
You can visit Bedford Citizen and click on the link for a detailed summary of our volunteer program, events, and fundraising activities, along with Bedford TV's performance and fiscal health throughout the past year. It's also up on our About section at bedford.tv.
Very good. Was it fiscally healthy, Jen?
Yes. I mean, this is public information, but we did have an underrun.
Tell.
Don't my math, right? But yes, it was, I don't know how to, that's where I'm combining work and volunteering.
You can get all the line.
Interesting, because if you look at the ones from prior years, it gives you a nice snapshot of like what Bedford TV actually does. Like, you know, when I mentioned that I wasn't, you know, I'm stepping down for the news, you know, after August, and then people are like, oh, you're not employed anymore. I'm like, I don't work. This isn't my job. And people think that we get paid for it, and we're all volunteering our time right now. So,
Get paid in smiles.
What's that?
You get paid in smiles.
We do get paid in smiles and pats on the back.
Well, a major new local employer who does pay his employees moved one step closer to realization Tuesday when the planning board approved a revised Middlesex Turnpike site plan for a production facility for the biopharmaceutical company Ultragenyx. The so-called Bedford Woods location, a four-lot industrial park that was first addressed by the planning board in 1999, is at the northern extremity of the turnpike near the Billerica line. The board approved plans for one of two undeveloped lots. All five members, Chair Jeffrey Cohen, Jacinda Barbenhen, Stephen Hagen, Sean Hannigan, and Amy Lloyd, supported the proposed two-story, 100,000-square-foot structure. Hagen, who is also a member of the Conservation Commission, was concerned about the potential of snow removal into surrounding wetlands and encouraged a snow storage plan. Other topics included safety signage and a bus shelter beside the access road.
That's nice. So moving on to news about the library, the Bedford Free Public Library isn't yet able to reopen, but the library staff is using their creative skills to constantly come up with ways to serve you better in these uncertain times. The grab-and-go curbside pickup of books is working so well that an additional Saturday morning pickup time of 10 to noon will start on September 12th. A plan is underway for curbside pickup to take place in inclement weather as winter approaches. The actual pickup will happen in the library meeting room with a one-way entrance and exit path. The library trustees voted to revisit the question of fines when the building is reopened and to support the director in his decision to suspend fines. Pamela Agabian has devised an online browsing feature so readers can look over new books, both fiction and nonfiction. And a recent upgrade is an increase in the number of Wi-Fi access points from 6 to 18. Maybe next week I should do the news from the parking lot of the library and then we'd be good. because library Wi-Fi does extend outside around the perimeter of the building. So stay tuned. And there is a new queen in the beehive on the roof of the building, for those of you that forgot that there are bees in the building. So that's exciting.
Yeah, apparently something happened to the queen, but now there's a new queen. Want to know more about bees? Do you see lots of bees, honeybees, at your bird bath or loitering around your wet laundry on your laundry line or your dripping garden faucet? Bridget DeWeer tells us this is good news. You have a honeybee colony within 2 miles. Why do you notice their abundance these days in those odd places? We are in the dog days of summer. It is hot and the bees need water to cool their hives. They place tiny drops of liquid around the honeycomb cells, and then they stand over them and fan them with their wings, evaporating the water and thus lowering the temperature in their nest. You can help them by keeping your bird bath filled and admire them as they line up in a perfect circle around the edge of the water table, happy. These bees are not out to sting you while you lend them a gentle hand to keep cool and let them be.
And switching over to mosquitoes instead of bees, and other insect news, the Bedford Board of Health reminds residents that it's mosquito season. The Massachusetts Department of Health has announced this year's first human cases of West Nile virus, a resident of Middlesex County in their 50s, and the first Eastern equine encephalitis, EEE virus infection, which is a male under the age of 18 who is exposed to EEE in Plymouth County. To date this year, the EEE virus has been found in 40 mosquito samples and West Nile virus in 30 mosquito samples, including in species of mosquitoes capable of spreading the virus to people. So reduce your risk for mosquito bites by taking a few common sense precautions. Mosquito-proof your property, be aware of peak mosquito hours, clothing can help reduce mosquito bites, and apply insect repellent when you go outdoors. Makes sense.
Yes, always good things to remember. We have a string of military stories this week. The steeple bell at First Parish told an observance of the devastation wrought by the first atomic bomb dropped on Hiroshima on August 6th, and several activists demonstrated along the Great Road in front of the common. The congregation service on August 9th marked the anniversary of the second bomb dropped on Nagasaki. Then this past Saturday, August 15th, 2020, it was the 75th anniversary of VJ Day, marking both the surrender of Japan and the end of the Second World War. The Bedford Citizen thanks Joe Damery for sharing his memories of Bedford on VJ Day, the day World War II ended, August 15th, 1945. Joe writes, and I think, believe he said he was 15 when it happened, President Truman announced it on the radio at 7 p.m. on that date. The fire whistle blew till it simply ran out of air. Our whole town met uptown at the town hall, and we all got fire engine rides. We kids got to pull the rope, ringing the first church bell on the common. Most all that evening, at the Congregational Church, the chimes played patriotic songs. People shot guns into the air, and some had saved firecrackers for the occasion. Down at the B&M Roundhouse, the night watchman Fred had backed out a steam loco, and we all got to ring its bell and blow that train whistle for hours. Great night for all Bedfordites, never to be forgotten. I hope he submitted that to the Bedford Historical Society. That really paints a noisy picture.
Then congratulations to Asu Sain, an airman first class stationed at Hanscom Air Force Base, who became a U.S. citizen on July 2nd. The 36-year-old Baghdad native worked as a translator for coalition forces in Iraq for more than 5 years before immigrating to the United States, where he subsequently joined the Air Force. Last month at a ceremony in Northampton, A1C Hussein culminated months of preparation when he completed the final exam of his naturalization test and was sworn in as a U.S. citizen. Hussein knew that physical distancing precluded any kind of celebration, but his colleagues from the 66th Comptroller Squadron back at base housing had other ideas. Hussein said, I'll never forget driving up to my house and seeing the decorations and congratulations sign across my garage door. I was so shocked, but then I saw my coworkers and my neighbors come around the corner with a red, white, and blue cake. I just wanted to jump. I was so happy. That's so sweet.
That's an easy
test. Yeah. My mom became a citizen much later in life when she passed the test. That's not an easy test to take.
Oh, really?
Yeah. You had to like really know your, you know.
Really know your constitution? Your
government, all that. Yep.
Oh, well, I don't think you have to pass the test to be a VA volunteer. Luckily, volunteers at VA Bedford Healthcare System are being gradually and safely reintroduced to operations after a brief pause to reduce the spread of COVID-19. Volunteers are critical and valued members of VA's healthcare team and assist with a variety of services that help its staff provide high-quality, compassionate care to veterans and their families. VA Bedford benefits from the services of more than 700 individual volunteers each year, says Medical Center Director Joan Clifford. Prior to the pandemic, we had 75 volunteers or more on duty each day, helping to make us a healthcare center of excellence, and we are happy to see them starting to return. It is still important to take precautions and prevent the spread of COVID-19, and volunteers can expect the following safety measures, including a phased reentry, retraining, and health screenings.
The Bedford Citizen proudly welcomes Laura Bullock to their board of directors. A longtime community activist, Laura has written several popular articles for the Citizen and helped to assure success for their annual Bedford Guide. Laura Bullock was elected to the board of directors of the Bedford Citizen at its annual meeting on April 22nd. She's a longtime resident of Bedford with interests that range from protecting Fawn Lake to heading up a local basketball program to fundraising for the first Habitat for Humanity home construction. In addition to these volunteer activities, Bullock is a licensed realtor presently working with local agency as a home stager. Bullock stated, quote, I love that the Bedford Citizen involves both news and happenings and is produced by those who live here. Everyone has the opportunity to be involved and can submit an article or photo or write a letter to the editor. I have such respect for all who are already on the board and I'm thrilled to join them. Welcome, Laura.
We have some exciting news in the world of books. Bedford's newest published author is Elizabeth Lizzie Siebert, whose first novel, The Bro Code, will be released on September 22nd. If you can't wait until then, you can view the cover, read a synopsis of this young adult novel, and pre-order the book on both the Amazon and Barnes & Noble websites. It will be available in bookstores too, published by Wattpad Books. The Bro Code actually began when Lizzie was in high school. She found the storytelling platform, Wattpad.com, and began posting stories on it, gaining a substantial following. The original draft of the Bro Code won Wattpad's Most Popular Humor Story, Wattie Award, like that their awards are called Watties, in 2012. And to date has chalked up more than 22 million reads. It is still available there, but as Lizzie points out, the published version is significantly different. As a reporter for the Bedford Citizen, Lizzie covered the Finance Committee, Housing Partnership, and the March annual town meeting in 2017 until she left Bedford to take a full-time job writing content for a digital advertising agency.
And now to what's coming up this week. Well, today, there are several meetings coming up, but today, Monday at the 17th, the Select Board will be meeting remotely at 7 p.m. On Tuesday, tomorrow, August 18th, the Hanscom Field Advisory Commission will meet at 7 p.m. And on Wednesday, August 19th, the Conservation Commission will meet at 6 p.m. You can check the Town of Bedford website for Zoom links to participate and to view meeting agendas.
On Saturday morning, there will be a story time featuring diverse stories. They will gather via Zoom at 10:30 a.m. on Saturday, August 22nd. Story time will be presented by Miss Bethany and Ms. Elaine, children's librarians of the Bedford Free Public Library. This special event is co-sponsored by the school department's Parents Diversity Council, and Bedford Embraces Diversity. And finally, a save the date, listening sessions to solicit residents' opinions and concerns via Zoom. Bedford Connect is convened by Select Board member Bopa Malone and Planning Board member Jacinda Barbahan. The next meeting is set for Wednesday, August 26th from 5 to 6:30. If you are curious and want to join the conversation, you can send your name to bedfordconnect@yahoo.com. Instructions and a Zoom link will be sent to you.
Well, the weather has been delightful lately. It rained yesterday, but like I'm loving the 70 degree weather that's been going on.
I didn't even mind the rain. It was sort of lovely.
Yeah, it's a nice break from waking up and it's like 104.
Yeah, from the step outside. Ugh.
Yeah, it's like been muggy and whatever. But let's see what Paul's got in store for us for the weather for this week.
Hello, I'm Paul, and here's a look at our weather for the week ahead. This weather report is based on the forecast from the National Weather Service and Weather Underground websites. The upcoming week will start with some possible showers tonight and then end with some possible rain at the end of next weekend. We only got a little over a tenth of an inch from yesterday's showers. We've had so little rain, we're in a moderate drought, so we'll take whatever rain we can get to water our lawns and gardens. Most of this week ahead is looking dry, but actually very nice, with highs in the mid-80s and lows in the 50s and 60s. Today was mostly cloudy with a forecast high of 77. There's a 50% chance of some showers this evening that'll last into tomorrow morning. The low tonight will be near 63. Early tomorrow morning, there's a chance of some leftover showers. Then the rest of the day will be mostly sunny with a high near 85. On Tuesday night, the low will be around 60. Wednesday will be partly cloudy but mild. The high will be near 81, and the low Wednesday night will be around 56. Thursday is the pick of the week. It'll be sunny with low humidity and a high near 81. The low Thursday night will be around 56. Friday should also be a nice day. It'll be mostly sunny and warming up to the high around 86. The low overnight will be around 64. Next Saturday, it'll continue to be mostly sunny with increasing winds and a high near 88. Saturday night will become cloudier with a chance of some showers and a low around 66. Sunday will be partly cloudy in the morning with an increased chance of some much-needed showers in the afternoon and evening. The high will be near 83, and the low Sunday night will be around 63. And then next Monday will be cloudy with a good chance of some showers in the afternoon. The high will be near 79, and the low will be near 61. Now here's a quick recap of the weather for this week. Today was partly cloudy with possible evening showers. Tuesday will be mostly sunny and mild. Wednesday will be partly cloudy. Thursday will be sunny and nice. Friday and Saturday will be mostly sunny and getting warmer. Next Sunday, there will be possible showers in the afternoon and evening. And then next Monday will be cloudy with showers. So that's the weather for the week ahead. Back to you, Jen and Dawn.
All right, so this is like an hour in the life of what it's like for Bedford TV news right here. So I'm going to, there's Dawn's dog who hopefully is alive. Yes. Where are you, Dawn?
I'm breathing.
Okay. So I'm unhooking my phone right now from my tripod. My pop socket broke, which is like a sign that I need to get to the stupid Apple store and get a new phone. So I'm going to just turn myself around here. I could just switch my camera. but my phone is not being, oh no, here it is. There we go. All right, so here's my setup, just to give you a heads up. So this was my tripod I had hooked up, which I try to get in line with the, you know, the little thingy on here that this is like where you are, to try to line up this with the tripod, because here's a script that we have. So what I was doing with my hand is, you know, here's a script, Dawn writes this, and you know, we have people that edit and put in all the links and stuff. And this is like the stuff that you guys don't see. So Mike has to go through and show you these pictures, and he's got like 25 computers in his room to try to figure out how to do all this stuff. So like, we've got to scroll through all this stuff as you read. And they do have teleprompter apps, but I've found that scrolling through Google Docs is actually faster and easier than using the, whatchamacallit, the teleprompter app. So there's a tripod. And then Mike also gave me the suggestion of buying that jammy thing, which is a, I guess you'd call it a light, no? Mike's on mute. Can you unmute Mike?
Is that the technical name for it?
I don't know. Okay. Okay, so this is called the light, right? And the light has different things in it, so you could like switch out different colors, like this comes out. And I have to make sure my shades there, because the light starts to come in and then it puts stripes on my face. So I have this actually up on a little on a step stool on my kitchen table. There's the box of the tripod when I'm like, uh-oh, my internet's not working. And there's water in case I start to cough and need to get off air. So yeah, so that's my setup.
My setup's not interesting. I just have dogs.
And yeah, that's what Dawn's actual...
I have another one. I'll go show you the other one. All right, say bye, Waffles. It's not saying.
There's so much behind the scenes that we do that, you know, there's so many moving parts. Like, you know, Paul does the weather. He pre-records that beforehand. Alan Tate goes through all the images and makes sure that they're cropped okay. We've got Prakar Gupta and Ann Siemens, who, like, whichever anchor hasn't been on has been editing the news in the morning, and then, you know, we had an interview, so we do a pre-news Zoom. So it's like, gosh, 12 hours, I would say, of stuff that we probably put together. Yeah, it's a long process to put this to you. But, oh, there's Dawn's other dog.
That's Jasmine. He's elderly.
Do your dogs move, Dawn?
This one doesn't move as much.
Which one is the dog who had the what do you call it, the twig through his arm?
Oh yeah, that's Play-Doh Waffles. Okay. This one doesn't run through the forest.
That's
this is the one that runs through the forest. Oh, this is hard.
All right, so are you going to come back on camera so we can officially sign off?
Sure.
Okay, there right. We go.
My God, Mike is obsessed with this dog here. All right, say goodbye, Play-Doh Waffles. Are you going to wave?
Aww.
Oh, he doesn't like that. Does not like his paws touched. He's left the building. All right, good night.
Thank you for joining us here for the ramshackle, this is how we do it, news broadcast today. And we will see you all next week. Bye.